Mic check, 1, 2, 1, 2. This is the soundtrack, heavy is the crown coming to you. Mic check, it's your girl Queen. We on the scene, you know what I mean? Mic check, 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 2, 2, 2, 2. All right, all right, all right. It's your girl Queen. You are currently tuned into Heavy is the Crown. You are tuned into my podcast. And shout out to all my listeners. Shout out to everyone who's been effing with me. Everybody who's been keeping up with me. Sending me good words and strong positive vibrations about my podcast and everything that I'm doing right now. Appreciate you. Please also excuse my tardiness. Had some personal ish. You know, I needed to get together. Had to get my mind right. It's very important to have your mind right. And yeah, I had to do that. And now I'm back with another one. Like I said, it's your girl Queen. You're tuned into Heavy is the Crown. This is episode 5. And of course, I'm going to do the daily routine. We'll have a guest later. On this episode, the focus will be the strained relationships between mothers and daughters, specifically in the Black community. So, I do want to talk about that. And before I do talk about that, I would like to preference that, and I'm probably going to say this multiple times during the episode because I just want to make it crystal clear, just throw out any reminders. I'm not saying that all Black mothers are this way or these ways that we will discuss today on this episode of Heavy is the Crown. However, we all... in the Black community, I feel confident in saying that we all know of a Black mother who has shown these characteristics. Some of us have experienced these Black mothers and these characteristics of Black mothers that will be discussed on this episode. Some of us are those mothers. Some of us have friends or family members who are those mothers. Some of us have friends or family members who have those mothers. Either way, please don't come in the comments. Please don't hit me up saying, well, it's not all Black mothers. I know that. So I want to make it clear. I know it's not all Black mothers. However, this is an issue that I really want to talk about because we have to unite. And one of the most important things, I believe, in a community, especially in the Black community, one of the things that we are lacking or that we can work on is the foundation of the family, the Black family. So, you know, we need to, you know, acknowledge these things that may be hindering us or that would just make our community more powerful and more successful. But before I get into that, queens, kings, follow me, Instagram at _heavyisthecrown. I have a book club, Queens Read. Queens that's listening to this right now, come on now. I know y'all can twerk. I know you can make rebuttals on social media, you feel me? I know y'all fine. I know y'all got the eyelashes popping and all that. Got the locks, you know, the retwist popping. But, you know, let's join this book club. You know, let's add another hobby. Let's add, another pastime. You feel me? So I do have a book club. It is called Queens Read. And so we had our first meeting with these group of women that I have now with me, these group of queens that I have with me. We read The Incidents from a Slave Girl, or The Incidents of a Slave Girl, excuse me, by Harriet Jacobs. And I just wanted to ask some of my girls how they felt about the book club and how they felt about the Zoom meeting, because, you know, this pandemic got us all, you know, remixing everything and being innovative and finding new ways to do things. So we did our book club meeting on Zoom and I felt like it was pretty bomb. But you know what? Before we get into this serious topic, let's see what some of the ladies from my book club, Queens Read, felt about, you know, I link up. You hear me? I link up. It's your girl Queen. You're tuned into Heavy is the Crown. Let's do it. Hey, yo, Frank A, how was your Queens Read Book Club experience?
My experience was amazing. Like, it was just nothing but good vibes. We was talking about the book, and then we started talking about ourselves and just, like, what it's like just being a Black woman. And it's just a really informative and healthy space to be in. I encourage all of my Black queens to join. I've had so many of my friends asking, can they join? And I'm like, of course, but we're really serious. Get the book, read the book. And our first meeting was just amazing. We had mimosas and brunch. We was on Zoom. We was just really chilling. It was people making breakfast on the Zoom call. I was doing my hair on the Zoom call. So it's just a no judgment free zone. It was amazing.
This time we will be reading a book by Eric Jerome Dickey. It's called The Business Between Lovers. And Frankie, have you gotten your book yet?
No, I have not gotten my book yet. I'm definitely going to purchase it after I get off. But I cannot wait. The first book was really good. And I'm really excited for this next book because we're not, like, you know, we're not just reading, like, the typical slave story. We're actually really diverse in our book club. We're reading about all different types of books. If you have not joined Queen Read, girl, what is you doing? You need to join, ladies. You need to join and get informed and just be around positive Black queens that want to see everybody win. It's no hate. It's nothing but love and encouragement. Also, listen to this podcast, period.
Hey, my good sis Shianda, how you feel about Queen's Read Book Club?
I think the book club is hella dope. So going into the idea, I didn't know what to really expect. I think one of the biggest concerns I had was, would I be able to keep up because I'm in school and I'm a teacher and I have so much going on. I like the fact that the group is full of women from different walks of life. Like, there were women who were in their 30s. There were women in the group that were in their 20s. You know, there were women in the group who went to college and women in the group probably never went to college. And I think that's awesome because with the type of real talk topics we had surrounding the book, it allowed us to hear perspectives outside of our own perspective. And that's kind of powerful. It allowed us to see perspectives that were different from our own. And in the end, a lot of our perspectives on different topics changed. I like the fact that, yeah, we talked about the book, but I appreciated the fact that when we had our group discussions, the discussions weren't just about the book, but it were topics that were themed and connected to the things that were happening in the book. It allowed us to talk about our own society and things that we see, issues that we see in our own communities. And I think it's hella dope. We had really strong intellectual conversations, and that's what I feed off of. I love intellectual conversations. And I also like the fact that even people in the group who may not have read up to the same place as everyone else were still able to engage in the conversation. So I'm excited about it. This is something I've always wanted to be a part of, but just didn't know, you know, how to or who had this type of platform to be involved with it. So I'm really excited about it. I just downloaded the second book. I've already started reading it, so I'm trying to get ahead. I'm trying my best to get ahead. But I think, you know, I think that anyone that enjoys Black culture, you know, any woman that enjoys Black culture, love discussing the issues that our community faced would love being a part of this group. And I'm excited about it.
So, you heard it here first. Now, don't say that we didn't tell you when you know that we did. Be sure to go on Facebook, search Queens Read. You'll find myself as well as my other ladies there. Whole bunch of queens just reading. Make sure to follow me on Instagram @_heavyisthecrown. Slide in my DM and I will tell you what book we are reading next. Until then, let's tune into this tune. I'll be right back. It's Heavy Is the Crown.
Don't say, baby, your thighs do. I want us to arrive together. I love it when the weather is wet and sticky. Some depict me as being conscious. Yeah, I use my head. It was you that fed my appetite for seduction. Biting and cussing, making love and touching when no one has ever touched before. The heat got you open like an oven door because of your innocence. Even more, you'll remember this hardcore gentleness. Before you wasn't into this, on the ride, your freak became limitless. Holding on to the night and me tight as we write on the walls. A story called Go. And receive it with openness. Emotions just spill. I'm giving you something that you can feel. It's hard to stay still. Rubbing your desires up against mine. I feel you shaking. I'm thinking that it's time. My fingers on the hook of your neck. Deep in your eyes is a look of respect. Soft, wet, brown sugar mixed with cinnamon. Said you learning to trust men again. But this is love, made unselfish. Made for you to feel empowered at the same time helpless. You dealt with a lot in your screams and moans. There's something about your warmth that I've seen, I'm home. But we don't have to think no more. It's synchronicity and raw. And this is what I came here for.
The Crown, I know you enjoying the sounds because each and every episode is going down. It's your boy Dan and Michael, and I'm tuned in with my girl Queen. Make sure you turn your stations up. Let's go.
All right, y'all. It's your girl Queen. You are currently tuned into Heavy is the Crown podcast. This is episode 5. And let's just get right back into this topic. So dysfunctional relationships between moms and daughters, specifically in the black community. I think that this topic is very, very important. There's no secret that daughters have a very special bond with the father. There's no secret that the son typically has a very special bond with the mother. However, there is another side to that. And I would like to talk about it. I would like to talk about it, one, because unfortunately, I can relate to this dysfunctional relationship between, or that can occur between a daughter and a mother. Also, like I said prior, I just don't think that it's a topic that we talk about enough in the community. I mean, a lot of these things just trickle down, and as soon as we can find out what's hindering us and just catch it right there, acknowledge it, work through it, I am a strong believer that we will be better as a community. With that being said, daughters who are in relationships with their mothers that are toxic or that are dysfunctional. What does a dysfunctional mother look like? The dysfunctional toxic mother normally speaks down to her children or to her child. That mother normally speaks down about the father in front of the child, or speaks down to the father in front of the child. A toxic mother keeps her kids away from the father. A toxic mother in the relationship with her daughter, there's always some type of competition. A toxic mother in during the relationship with her daughter is violent, is abusive. No matter if this is physical abuse or verbal abuse, these women tend to be have a very, very strong tongue. Okay? This mother in this type of relationship does not respect personal boundaries at all. This mother towards this daughter withholds love. This mother, 9 times out of 10, does not teach femininity. And when I say femininity, I am speaking of hygiene. I'm speaking of, you know, just knowing how to be a woman towards a man. Just knowing how to be a woman in public, how to be classy, just femininity. One thing that this mother does in this dysfunctional relationship, or better yet, she doesn't or hasn't done, is deal with your own trauma. Now, anyone in any situation who is being overly toxic or dysfunctional, obviously that is something that comes from their past. That is something that is coming from their upbringing. A lot of these mothers who are toxic or dysfunctional towards their daughters have yet to deal with traumas that have happened to them. And which is very interesting, because a lot of the women whom I've had this conversation with, who can also relate to experiencing this type of mother, it was like one or the other. They were either scared to have children, or they couldn't wait to have children. Scared to have children because, you know, you don't want to do those same things that your mother did to you. Sometimes I think it's scary in your mind because you cannot want to be like someone so bad. However, when you're around them on a daily basis, some of these things are normal to you. You have to be very conscious. It is going to be a work in progress not to be like that person. Some of the women who were saying that they wanted to have a baby or start a family quickly is because they wanted to prove
that they weren't the type of mother or woman, you know, that their mother was towards them. You know what? To be honest, like I said before, this is something that I have struggled with my entire life. The relationship with my mother. And it's like I've gone through totally different phases. And I'm actually going to go into what those phases were and have been a little bit later on in the podcast. However, like I said, I'm going to be honest, and this is something that I am still working on. This is something that I talk to my therapist about a lot. A lot is an understatement. This is something I speak to my therapist about every session. It is something that I cognitively, you know, I have to consciously, I have to really, really put in effort to make sure that I do not replica or reenact things that I didn't like. I'm not a professional. I would never pretend to be a professional. However, that's why I do have a professional who is going to join us. I'm going to get him on the line. He is a therapist. And we're just going to ask him for his professional insight on this topic, dysfunctional relationships between the daughter and the mother, specifically in the Black community. And yeah, let's get him in on this line so y'all can stop hearing me ramble. Let's get some professional help. It's your girl, Queen. Heavy is the crown.
Hello, how are you doing today?
I'm doing well. How are you?
Good, good, good. Well, first of all, I do want to say thank you, show my gratitude for even taking time out of your busy schedule to converse with me a little bit. But if you could you just introduce yourself to the internet and tell them, you know, what you do?
Absolutely. Well, first, thank you for having me. It's my pleasure to come on and talk to you. I'm a big fan. My name is Jamar Moore. I'm a licensed therapist in the state of Maryland. I have my own private practice right now. And before that, I used to work in a number of places. I worked for a large agency with family services. That job required a lot of work with families and children that were homeless. And before that, I was actually in the military for 9 years with the Navy. And I did some government work, some government contracting, and finally decided to do what I love, which is help people help themselves in counseling. And I finished my master's degree at Bowie State University. And now I've been in private practice for the last 3 years. So I'm doing that and I thoroughly enjoy it. And now I'm here with you today.
Well, thank you again. Welcome. And congratulations on starting your private practice. We need a lot of that. You're welcome. Mental health and mental wellness has been something spotlighted in the Black community in the last few years, I would say maybe 5 to 10. And I think it's really good. So we appreciate you. You say you do therapy. You did name a few of the different types of therapy. Is it incorrect to ask, do you do like anger management or marriage counseling, or what type of therapy do you hone in on now within your private practice?
Okay. So I'll give you the little lay of the land. Most of what I do right now, because of COVID-19, has been a lot of anxiety, depression, and just people trying to get a hold on their mental health during this time. I do specialize in relationship counseling. So I do a lot of marriage counseling, a lot of counsels to singles, a wide range of ages. You'd be surprised. I see I used to see some teenagers here and there, but once school kind of picked back up, that kind of fell off. But it's pretty broad, I would say, pretty broad. We deal with all ages, all ethnic groups, all sexuality, all of that.
Your last statement actually brought me to something I was actually really curious about. During the pandemic, are you saying that you've been getting more anxiety issues or clients with anxiety issues due to the pandemic? And how has it been? Are you doing like phone counseling, or how has that changed? The pandemic changed the operation of your private practice?
Well, yes, because of the pandemic, we did have to switch to 100% virtual counseling. And that's basically what we've been doing since, I want to say, mid-March. And it's been pretty busy, I got to say, because of the change that has brought to everyone. It has affected everyone. No one on planet Earth is living a normal life in this pandemic right now. Some people may be comfortable, but everyone has had to make an adjustment in some way. So with that, we had to make adjustments as well. We want our clients to feel safe, and we don't want to infect anybody, and we don't want to get infected ourselves. So we wanted to just make sure that we adjusted properly. And there has been an increase in anxiety, you know, with people losing their jobs, with people losing income. You know, some people didn't lose their jobs, but they did lose some of their income. Small business owners, stuff like that, they had to make certain adjustments. So that's a stressor for people. And here we are available, making ourselves available to people. And we actually did some advertisement for it as well to let people know that even though you can't come to our office, you can still see us virtually. You don't have to find a new therapist, because we have people that used to come into the office all the time, but were kind of skeptical about seeing someone online. They felt like, oh, it might not be the same feel. You know, I like the one-on-one. But, you know, once you get used to it, I'd say from like the first or second visit, it's just like having a FaceTime conversation or a Zoom conversation. You can still talk about what's going on with you in a safe place. And honestly, a lot of people have been more willing to do it because they don't have to fight through traffic to get to their appointment.
Yeah.
You can do it in the comfort of your own home. You know what I'm saying? So it's a lot easier in that aspect.
Thank God for technology, right? You know, you got to take the good with the bad. So I wanted to have you on today. Obviously, you're a great therapist. I personally value your counseling personally myself. So I thought that it would be perfect to have you on here and just chat with me a little bit today, for this episode. In this episode, I have been talking about mother-daughter relationships in the Black community specifically. I personally can relate to having a dysfunctional relationship as a daughter with my mother. However, I have also noticed that I seemingly am not alone, that this is not an abnormal thing, specifically in our community. Seems like it is something that happens across the board. And just in your experience, in your professional experience, have you counseled women with these type of faulty relationships with their mothers?
Yes, I have. First of all, thank you for that compliment. That was very nice of you to say. secondly, here's the crazy thing, and I don't use crazy as a scientific word. I had a conversation with a client and her mother just this morning for this very same topic. I lie to you not.
Wow.
And the day before that, I had another client that was talking to me about her relationship with her mother and how toxic it can be. Now, just from looking at it from same sex parent aspect, usually the same sex parent is the one you're going to have the most, you're going to butt heads the most with. Now, I don't understand why that is, but the research that I've done while I was in school basically just says this is the person that you're going to emulate, okay? Mm-hmm. And a lot of times our parents, when we come out of them, they want to see us kind of be them and make the same decisions that they made. And when you have a child that you believe is going to make right decisions and going to do the things you want them to do, and they start doing the opposite, now friction starts to come into place. And there's so many variables that play into this thing. You know, we have people that have one mother, different dads, and the mother could look at one child differently than the other because she's mad at the father over something, you know, different things right. like that. And then there's a cultural aspect to it where people who come from different countries come to this country with a one mindset, and they're raising their children here, and they're used to the United States in this society where their parent is used to a different society. So they're growing up here, but their parents are teaching them a different way of life, and they right. butt heads. So those kind of things come into play. And I gotta tell you, this is something that happens all the time. I'm glad you are talking about this, because the mother-daughter relationship in the African-American community, it can go so many ways. And we're not even talking about abuse yet. You know, we're not right. talking about traumatic events yet. You know, all those things play into the parent and child relationship.
What I've been, not just in my personal experience, just with me having certain different conversations with people, or this conversation with different people, I should say, it seems as if there is some type of dysfunctional cycle in the Black community with the relationship between the daughter and the mother, for different mm-hmm. reasonings. Not just speaking about on myself, but just in general, some things that I've heard from other people, just, you know, mothers being, you know, withholding love or being violent, just the competition or the competitive atmosphere that I feel like a mm-hmm. lot of us, like daughters, experience with our mothers. Really the lack of even teaching like that femininity. And mm-hmm. again, I'm not saying this about every mother-daughter relationship in the Black community. I'm just saying that I feel like this is an issue that needs to be spoken about. I feel like in our community, we speak about absent fathers and deadbeat fathers, which is a real thing and a real issue as well. I just don't feel like we, as a community, discuss the effects that our mothers can have on us, especially women. And with that being said, I know that men also experience this as well. But just like you were saying prior, that the same sex will bump heads, and it's interesting to see how like the daughter is usually like that typical daddy's girl, and then like the son is like that stereotypical mama's boy or whatever. But when mm-hmm. that does happen for men, have you counseled men who have had faulty relationships with their mothers, and what seem to be the differences, if you have?
I have. Typically with mothers and sons, a mother kind of has a softer approach to their son. Have you ever noticed in maybe a different family or maybe a friend, you saw how the mother and the son had like a different bond than the father and the daughter? Like the uh-huh. daddy's girl thing and mama's boy thing, that really comes into play here, because you can see a daughter not be able to get the same type of reaction out of her mom than she does her dad. And mm-hmm. the dad won't give the same reaction to his son than the mother will. And what I mean by that is, let's say a son wants to do something. He goes to his dad. Papa's like, nah, boy, you ain't doing that. And he goes to his mom, and she's like, oh, well, let me just ask your father, you know, that kind of thing. And when it's reversed, the daughter goes to the father, and she's like, well, daddy, can I do this? And he's like, oh, baby, sure. Let's talk to your mother about it. And mama's like, she don't need to be doing that. She don't need to be doing that. It's that type of dynamic. It's almost like it's like ingrained in us to battle against our same-sex partner or child and parent, because I have two sons and a daughter. My daughter is 16. My one boy is 10. My other boy turns 4 tomorrow. And I'm going to raise my son differently than I'm raising my daughter. Because I'm raising my boys to not only be the type of man that can provide, but I'm raising them to be black men in this country, which is
right.
a challenge in and of itself. I'm not saying it's a greater challenge from an African-American woman, but it's the type of challenge that I can speak to. So I'm going to raise them in that light. And my daughter's going to raise my wife is going to raise my daughter in that light that she's used to. So there are different dynamics to this thing. And within my practice, getting back to your question, within my practice, what I have seen is that play out. Okay, I've seen mothers and sons have a better relationship than mothers and daughters. That's what I've seen. There are different, you know, versions of the story depending on who your mother is. And I don't know if you're going to get to this later, but what we don't tend to think about is the traumatic events and things that happen in our parents' life that kind of dictate their upbringing.
Mm-hmm.
Because when we look at our parents, we want to see somebody that has it all together, can answer all mm-hmm. my questions, will raise me the right way. But if they don't have it, they can't give it. And we don't always think about that as the children, okay? We want our parents to be the one to go to. Right. So when our parent is neglectful or absent because they work so much or abusive, we don't know their history sometimes, and we can't understand their actions. So sometimes it requires us to say, hey, look, what happened in your life? What was your life like?
Mm-hmm.
And what led you to have the thoughts and feelings you do today?
Exactly. And that's exactly what I was getting at when I said it seems like it's a dysfunctional cycle that's just continuing. You know what I'm saying? So, like, mm-hmm. I can use myself for an example, you know? So, like, it's exactly what you just spoke to. Like, whatever my relationship is with my mother, she hasn't done her due diligence to deal with whatever traumas and whatever happened that affected her negatively in her life. So mm-hmm. that has been put on to other people in her life, you know, and right. it's taken me a long time. Actually, I think I just really am starting to understand this, that I'm understanding, and I actually just said this earlier, I'm understanding that whatever someone else went through in their lives, whatever is hindering them, I should not allow that to hinder myself. However, when I was mm-hmm. a little girl, you know, just wanting to have a certain type of relationship with my mom and this wasn't happening, that's what I mean when I say, like, that cycle just continues, because thankfully for me, I have other things to balance that out. For instance, mm-hmm. my relationship with my father, you know, and then just other things as well. However, there are women, there are girls out there who feel the same exact way that I was feeling growing up, but they don't have that thing to balance, you know, their lifestyle or how they're being treated. What should those girls do? You know, and like I said, it took me a long time to really understand that I shouldn't take certain things personally from other people.
Right.
But like I said, it took me a long time to figure that out. So what do you say to the young black girl who is trying to figure this thing out?
Well, I think it's going to require some communication and asking the tough question. You know, we look at our parents as the example, as the role model, and we seldom ask the question to ourselves, what was my mother's experience growing up? What are some of the things she battled with? And am I going to her for something that she's not able to give me? You know, we would like to think that our parents have all the answers and that they can, you know, help us out or guide us in the right direction. But that might not be the reality of the situation. You know, they have a past. and things have affected them in a way that has shaped their whole life. And then they throw a child into the mix. What if my mother never had the opportunity to see the example of a good mother? What if my mother saw a relationship as a man beating a woman as normal? I have a family member that told her daughter, a man doesn't love you unless he hits you. Mm. And when we look at some of the stuff in our social media as Black people, The Color Purple is a popular movie that a lot of us know. And when Seeley said to Harpo, beat her, it was a shocking thing to hear that from a woman, especially one that was being physically abused herself. Mm-hmm. Almost as if to say, if you want her to listen to you, then you have to beat her. That's what my husband does to me.
Mm-hmm.
And that kind of thing gets passed down to generation to generation. So who is going to be the one to stop it? That's where the change comes in. That's where the communication and the educating of ourselves comes into play. So I didn't grow up with my father. He was not around. I grew up with a single mother. My mother was adopted. Within the family, she was adopted. But at the same time, she was still shown love and support from two healthy people.
Mm-hmm.
And she grew up seeing what a healthy relationship was, even though she was adopted. And she was able to pass that on to me. Even without a father being in my life, I was still able to see what a healthy parent was.
Right.
But I didn't know all the things that she had been through in her life until I started asking questions.
Mm-hmm.
And then she started to share with me that, oh, yeah, I was in college. I was in nursing school. But I had to drop out because I had children to take care of. I could show up too tired to work, and a doctor told me to leave because I was too tired. So I made sure you all got your education, even though I wasn't able to finish mine, and my mother eventually went back to school, thank God. But those are the type of things you don't think about as a child.
Mm-hmm.
So to answer your question, it would be a great start to have that conversation. Hey, Mom, tell me about your life. Tell me about what you struggled with, what you dealt with. And then you can get a better understanding of what you're dealing with. Now, some of our parents aren't willing to share because, you know, culturally, we believe that we can just handle, you know, our stuff. We're taught, oh, just handle your stuff. You don't need to be sharing everything. That's why Black people, our people, don't really come to therapy that much because they figure, well, I'm not crazy. That's for crazy people.
Yeah.
You know, that's the big mess.
This house stays in this house.
Exactly. And we need to get rid of that. We got to get rid of that. We need to, you know, make a shift to my mental health is something that's important. And I have dealt with some things in life that have really bothered me. And it's okay to talk about it.
Just to play devil's advocate. And actually, devil's advocate, but my experience, and I've heard other women say this as well. Now, what if that young girl or that woman goes to her mother and she's trying to have this type of conversation, but this conversation is not receptive to the mother? It turns into a combative or, for lack of better term, toxic conversation.
Right.
Because I'm a strong believer that mothers who treat their daughters like that, they have some type of problem, things wrong with them internally. And I'm a strong believer that if we know as an individual, as a sound-minded individual, adult, if we cannot acknowledge that something is not right with us, that's a very difficult thing to try to tell someone, show someone that something is not all the way right with them if they don't see it themselves. So what about the woman who does, you know, try to initiate that conversation, but it just doesn't go through? I heard some women telling me that they moved out early, they got married early, or younger years in life, they had babies early. meaning they started their own family, they cut their mother off completely. And I feel like the women that I've had these conversations with, the majority of them are still in the process of trying. They're still on that journey, just as I am as mm-hmm. well. So what does a woman what does a woman do in that case if she can't have that conversation?
See, that's a tough question to answer, because the reality is some people will never be able to communicate in the way that we want. I know the boomer generation, one of the most successful generations ever, they have a hard time expressing how they feel about things, which can lead to misunderstandings, can lead to screaming and shouting and arguments and all that. And they believe that if they don't have that rough exterior, then they are somehow allowing someone to control them, walk over them, that sort of thing. So to combat that, the best approach is to reestablish the trust. You want to make sure that your parent understands the reasoning behind you coming to them. And it's not an attempt to use what they say against them, which can be the automatic thought sometimes. But, oh, you only want to know my history, so you can use it against me. Oh, you only want to know what I used to do back in the day, so you can go ahead and do it too and say, see, you used to do it. You know, mm-hmm. our parents would tell us not to smoke weed, not to drink, not to use crack and all that. But it's like, oh, but you did this back in the day. Mm-hmm. And a lot of times they parents keep that kind of stuff from us, thinking that if we look at them as a perfect being, that it'll be better. Like, nah, if you used to, you know, sleep with a bunch of men or a bunch of women and you saw that it was good for you, yo, let me know. So I don't go down the same path. I'm mm-hmm. not going to look at you and judge you, you know. So that's where you want to establish the trust. Hey, I'm trying to talk to you on a level that you can see I'm coming to you to understand what you went through and understand how to communicate to you, which brings me to the reframing of the communication. You know, having a level of respect that they can tell you're being sincere. You know, how mm-hmm. we speak to each other, how we even construct the sentence that we're saying can either make it or break it, you know. Mm-hmm. So if you're dealing with somebody that is not willing to talk, then that's where you would start, you know. Start from the ground up with the trust. Start with the communication. And if all else fails, you can try to bring in a third party, which would be somebody that they respect. And a lot of times with certain cultures and ethnic groups, this is a practice that some therapists revert to, because a lot of times they got to have someone that they respect and even admire to be that third person and say, hey, look, your daughter, mm-hmm. your son is just trying to get through to you, and they're trying to show you how important it is. So they asked me to come along and be that voice of reason. You know, it may require that. And if that still doesn't work, then you have to pretty much give yourself the closure with it, because not everybody can be reached. And that's one thing that's painful in his profession. You can't help everybody.
Right.
Especially people that don't want to be helped. There are some people, this one lady I talked to with her mom, her mother said, look, I'm not changing. This is who I am. You either take it or leave it. Mm-hmm. And there was nothing that we could do. Nothing we could do mm-hmm. with that.
And see, all of those tools, like with the trust, rebuilding the trust and everything, that sounds ideal to me. Like, in my mind, that sounds like it makes perfect sense to me. Like, this could be a very smooth, you know, transaction, a very smooth encounter. However, mm-hmm. in reality, like, it's just not a lot of the times. And also, just speaking for myself, I can't speak to every woman who's been in this situation or speak for her. Mm-hmm. But, like, with me, I have to, that sounds like something that a healed person could do, that a healed daughter could do. Right. Because, like, for me, Like I said, it's a work in progress. You know, I'm a work in progress, especially when it comes to this topic. Mm-hmm. However, the more that I realize and the more that I'm good with myself, the more that I am healing with this issue that I have with my mom, it's easier for me to try certain steps, you know. But at first, mm-hmm. and even now, to this day, with certain things, certain topics that her and I discuss or attempt to discuss, the only reason why I can do those things and not be emotional in those moments is because I'm in a healing process. I think that would be very difficult. I think those type of things would be difficult for the daughter that hasn't started that healing process. And with that being said, what are some things that woman could do? Because I feel like you got to be good with yourself before you try to fix something with someone else, you know?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. That's the easiest question right there. Find somebody to talk to, preferably a professional, to talk to your issues about, because you want to analyze everything that you're feeling. You want to understand why you're thinking what you're thinking, why you're feeling what you're feeling, because your thoughts are going to turn into your feelings. How you perceive things is going to turn into your feelings. And you want to understand all of that. You know, you may have some things that happened in the past or happened recently to you that's going to affect your judgment. And mm-hmm. you want to visit all of that stuff and come to some type of closure with it and understanding to it, so that when you do come to, you know, your mother and approach her with something, you're not doing it in a way where you're still confused about your own stuff.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Because if that's the case, you got two toxic people talking to each other, and that's never good.
Exactly. And I've actually been in that situation with my mother before, and I'm just thinking to myself, like, this isn't getting anywhere. Like, I mm-hmm. acknowledge my issues with my mother. However, at that time, I hadn't even started, you know, trying to fully understand why this situation was affecting me and even how much it was affecting me. With the healing method, so this young girl should definitely go and talk to a therapist. You said preferably a professional. When people mm-hmm. are going to go look for therapists, because as we already pointed out, you know, therapy, especially in the Black community, is becoming a household name, and it's not as taboo as it has been. However, for some people, it still is. But for the people who, I guess I'll ask this first. So for the individuals who are open to going to go find a therapist, what should these individuals look for in a therapist?
Okay, so that's going to depend on the person. So if you know you don't want to talk to, just for example, you don't want to talk to a male or female, then you look for what you want. Psychology Today is probably the best source that my clients use to locate a therapist, because they have a search engine in there. You can type in a number of things. You can type in Black male therapists in whatever area. You can type in anxiety, depression. You can type in PTSD. I mean, a number of things, and a lot of people will just pop up. All these therapists will pop up, and you can just go read through all of their profiles and select the one that you want. Usually when I get someone that has gone through, that has found me through Psychology Today, they say, well, I read your profile and I like what you had to say. You know, it had nothing to do with the way I looked, nothing to do with, you know, what I was wearing, you know what I'm saying? It was what mm-hmm. I said in my profile and the services that I offer. That's what the draw is.
And what is that site called again?
PsychologyToday.com.
Okay. And your website?
So if you go to site, my website is allthingsnewclinical.com. All together, allthingsnewclinical.com. And when you go to my website, mm-hmm. yeah, you're going to see a personal statement about me and my partner, who is my wife, and our backgrounds and what we're all about. And we specialize in a number of things, specifically relationship counseling, anxiety and depression, all of those things. So it's good to be picky with this.
Right. I think that's really important because, you know, it's almost like, I know this is like something totally different, but like when you find a good barber or when you find a good hairstylist,
yes.
You know, like when you find a good nail.
Exactly.
We need to make sure that we're all on the same accord. You know, people may have their preferences, you know.
Yeah, no,
so
you're
that's
absolutely
really good
right.
Information.
You're absolutely right.
As far as your website, is that the only way that people can contact you? Please let everyone know if they need a therapist, how they can get in contact with you to receive your services.
Yes, that is the best way to contact me. I also have our business line, which is 301-836-1702. If you're looking for an appointment, call that phone number. If I do not answer, please leave a message and I'll get back to you. If you don't want my services, don't leave a message because I don't just call random them back. I get numbers all the time. That's up. They must not be important. You can't leave no message. Leave a message and I will definitely call you back.
Absolutely. Thank you again so much for joining me. I'm going to let you go. I know you just penciled me in. I appreciate
it. Oh, absolutely.
That. Thank you so much.
Yes,
it's my pleasure.
On
you again.
Okay, no problem. You know, I bill 50 cents an hour, so, you know.
Right. Now, that's in my budget.
Well, let me clear the air on that. Let me not put that out there into the world.
You know, you said
50 cents an hour.
Right. No, but thank you so much. Thank you for all your input. And yeah, we're going to get this together. We're going to do our due diligence. Myself, Heavy is the Crown, my podcast, just trying to put some positive information out there to people who may be experiencing stuff. And like I said before, I'm not saying that this is every Black mother or every mother. I'm just saying that it's an important topic that I feel it needs some light shed on it. So thank you so much for helping me shed light on it here today.
Oh, it's my pleasure. Thank you for the invitation. I would love to come back. I appreciate what you're doing, and I wish you all the best in the future.
Thank you so much. Now go help your clients. And I will talk to you soon. Definitely. Stay safe. All righty.
You too. Thank you. Bye-bye.
No problem.
What's good? It's your boy, Inco Kaylee, Big Rue, not the little one, Rue Music Family. You now tuned in to Heavy is the Crown with the Queen. Watch your neck!
Alrighty, y'all. So I hope that everyone did get some good, credible information from Jamar. Like I was saying before, really, really dope therapist. Just to let you guys in on a little secret, he is my therapist. I highly recommend you all going to go and look into a therapist, especially women who, daughters who are going through this situation, especially the mothers, super especially the mothers, any mother who is listening to this episode, who feels like you can relate to this, you know, it ain't nothing wrong with going to go get some help, going to go talk to a professional, and just smoothing and unpacking things that have happened in your life and that continue to affect us every day. It's not just you, it's not just me. It seems to be, you know, something that all of us is dealing with in one way or another. Now, so as I was saying before, in my personal experience and in my personal dysfunctional relationship with my mother, I have gone through different phases. And so I did want to just touch on those phases just a little bit before we get out of here for this episode. So the first feeling that I, or the first phase slash feeling, I guess, that I can recall, the first one would have been denial. So, at first, when I was younger and I was experiencing this, I was just in denial. I didn't believe it. I went through moments of blaming myself, trying to quote unquote fix things about myself to be more satisfactory for my mother or towards my mother. It didn't work out. So I then had to get past that phase. Once I got past that phase, it was a competition phase. As I said before, a lot of these mothers, these kind of mothers, they have a characteristic of competition and of competing. And I know for a fact that me personally, I joined this competition. So that was always a thing, trying to, you know, make sure that I was, you know, doing everything that I could do to be looked at a certain type of way from my mom or by my mom versus my brother or my father, etc. The next phase that I went through after the competition phase was hate. And I think that I think that this hate phase kind of triggered, the hate phase and feeling has kind of been throughout this whole thing. But that was definitely a strong phase for me where I was just like, you know what, F this lady, you know what, F this, F all of this. I was just angry. That's when I sought out and got a therapist on my own and tried to correct myself. The next phase that I hit after that is the current phase that I'm in now, which I like to call the healing phase. So I'm doing my due diligence to make sure that I am healing myself and to make sure that I'm doing so in a productive way and not in a destructive way. And I hope that this episode has helped someone, sparked some help in someone. I don't know. I'm going to get out of here. I'm going to drop another episode. Thank you everyone for being patient with me. Thank you for everyone for even tuning in and kicking it with me. I really appreciate you all. And until next time, I love you all. It's your girl Queen, and this is Heavy as the Crown. I will see you next time.
So I don't fit in. That's hell. It's hell when you can't be around your peers. All my life grew up around black people, poor people, but I can't live around poor people now because they'll rob me. And why would they rob me? Because they're starving, because there's no money here. But they're telling me, now that I made a little money, I have to move here. So it's not like no one's ever trying to deal with this section. They're just moving away from it. And we're going to have more stars coming from together, but they're gonna all move this way. You know what I'm saying? So it's like all the society is doing is leeching off the ghetto. They use the ghetto for their pain, for their sorrow, for their culture, for their music, for their happiness, for their movies, to talk about boys in the hood. You know what I'm saying? I don't want to be another young. I don't want to be 50 years old at a BET We Shall Overcome Achievement Awards. You know what I'm saying? Uh-uh. Not me. You know, I want, when they see me, they know that every day when I'm breathing, it's for us to go farther. You know, every time I speak, I want the truth to come out. You know what I'm saying? Every time I speak, I want to shiver. You know, I don't want them to be like, they know what I'm going to say because it's polite. They know what I'm going to say. And even if I get in trouble, you know what I'm saying? That ain't that what we're supposed to do? I'm not saying I'm going to rule the world or I'm going to change the world. But I guarantee that I will spark the brain that will change the world. And that's our job, is to spark somebody else watching us. We might not be the ones, but let's not be selfish, and because we're not going to change the world, let's not talk about how we should change it. I don't know how to change it, but I know if I keep talking about how dirty it is out here, somebody's going to clean it up.